Myself, Dr. Abhinav Sharma, Senior Lecturer, Oral Medicine and Radiology Department, Subharti Dental College, Swami Vivekanand Subharti University, Meerut. Today I will be discussing cyst of orofacial region. Definition of cyst. A cyst is a pathological cavity having fluid, semi-fluid or gaseous contents, which is not created by the accumulation of pus. Most cysts, but not all, are lined by epithelium. They are of two types, true cyst and pseudocyst. True cyst, that which is lined by epithelium, like dentigerous cyst. Pseudocyst, not lined by epithelium. Parts of cyst: wall, that is made up of connective tissue, epithelial lining and lumen of cyst. Classification includes cyst of the jaws, epithelial, non-epithelial, and it is further divided into two, that is developmental and inflammatory. Developmental is further divided into two, that is odontogenic and non-odontogenic. According to the WHO classification, cyst of the jaws, oral and facial soft tissues. It is divided into two parts, that is intraosseous cyst and soft tissue cyst. Intraosseous cyst divided into three, that is epithelial, non-epithelial, cyst of the maxillary antrum. And epithelial cyst is divided into two, that is odontogenic and non-odontogenic cyst. Odontogenic again divided into two, that is developmental and inflammatory. Cyst of the jaws. Epithelial lined cyst. First is developmental origin. A, odontogenic, and B is non-odontogenic. Odontogenic includes gingival cyst of infants, keratocystic odontogenic tumor, dentigerous cyst, eruption cyst, gingival cyst of adults, developmental lateral periodontal cyst, botryoid odontogenic cyst, glandular odontogenic cyst, calcifying cystic odontogenic tumor. And non-odontogenic includes mid-palatal raphe cyst of infants, nasopalatine duct cyst and nasolabial cyst. Cyst of the jaws includes inflammatory origin, that is radicular cyst, residual cyst, periodontal cyst, inflammatory collateral cyst. B, non-epithelial lined cyst, that is solitary bone cyst, aneurysmal bone cyst and Stephanie's bone cyst. Cyst associated with the maxillary antrum, that is mucocele, retention cyst, pseudocyst, post-operative maxillary cyst. Cyst of the soft tissues of the mouth, face and neck. Dermoid and epidermoid cyst, lymphoepithelial cyst, thyroglossal duct cyst, anterior median lingual cyst, oral cyst with gastric or intestinal epithelium, cystic hygroma, nasopharyngeal cyst, thymic cyst, cyst of the salivary glands, mucus extravasation cyst, mucus retention cyst, ranula, polycystic disease of the parotid gland. And last one is parasitic cyst, that is hydrated cyst. Now, according to the Shears, 2006, frequency of epithelial cyst of jaws, so 52.30% of the cysts are radicular cyst, then 18.10% are dentigerous cyst, then 11.60% are odontogenic keratocyst, then 8% are residual cyst, and 5.60% are periodontal cyst. And rest of the unclassified odontogenic cyst are 4.20%. So the most common type of cyst is radicular cyst. Now we'll be discussing about epithelial line developmental origin. Odontogenic cyst. The first one is dentigerous cyst. The dentigerous cyst is defined as a cyst that originates by the separation of the follicle from around the crown of an unerupted tooth. The dentigerous cyst encloses the crown of an unerupted tooth and is attached to the tooth at the cemento-enamel junction. The pathogenesis of the cyst is uncertain, but apparently it develops by accumulation of fluid between the reduced enamel epithelium and the tooth crown. Thus, the cross specimen shows the dentigerous cyst around the crown portion. Clinical features: age, first to third decade of life; gender, most frequently seen in males than in females; site is 2/3 of the follicular cyst associated with unerupted mandibular teeth, primarily third molar; maxillary canine, mandibular premolar, followed by maxillary third molar, and supernumerary tooth also can be involved. Sign and symptoms: most cysts grow to a large size before being discovered accidentally while observing a dental x-ray to detect the cause of an unerupted tooth. Large lesions can cause cortical expansion leading to facial asymmetry. Teeth displacement can be seen, root resorption of adjacent teeth, even pain if it is infected secondarily. Otherwise, most of the times it is an incidental finding. Syndrome associated are Gordon-Gault syndrome and cleidocranial dysplasia or Moratiox-Lamy syndrome. Now the radiological features. Location: the epicenter is found just above the crown of the involved tooth. The cyst is attached at the CG level. In this radiograph, cyst related to maxillary molar often grow into the maxillary antrum, and cyst involving the mandibular molars may extend into the ramus region. So periphery manifest as unilocular, well-defined radiolucency with sclerotic margins associated with crown of impacted unerupted tooth. Internal structure: completely radiolucent except the crowns of involved tooth. Effect on surrounding structure is displaces and resorbs adjacent teeth. The involved tooth is commonly displaced in an apical direction. The cyst may displace the floor of the maxillary antrum and inferior alveolar nerve canal. Expansion of the outer cortical boundary of the jaw can be seen. In this radiograph, a central type of dentigerous cyst showing resorption of the root of the first mandibular molar. Radiograph of the two dentigerous cysts in the same patient. The cyst on the right is a lateral type and is on the left is a circumferential type. As you can see in this radiograph, differential diagnosis of dentigerous cyst are: first is hyperplastic follicle. How can we differentiate from dentigerous cyst to hyperplastic follicle is the size of the normal follicular space is 2 to 3 mm, and if the follicular space exceeds 5 mm, a dentigerous cyst is more likely. So size of the normal follicular space is 2 to 3 mm. Odontogenic keratocyst, less expansion of the bone, less likely to resorb teeth, not attached at the CEJ. It may not be possible to differentiate a small ameloblastic fibroma from a dentigerous cyst if there is no internal structure. Other rare lesions that may have similar pericoronal appearance are adenomatoid odontogenic tumors and calcified odontogenic cysts, both of which can surround the crown and root of the involved tooth. Aspiration often yields a straw-colored, thin liquid cholesterol crystals may be seen in aspirate. Treatment: surgical removal of the cyst. Complications can occur after the treatment. Recurrence is the most common thing. due to incomplete surgical removal, and development of ameloblastoma either from the lining epithelium or from odontogenic island in the connective tissue wall, development of SCC from same two sources, and development of mucoepidermoid carcinoma from mucus secreting cell in the lining. Now, keratocystic odontogenic tumor, OKC, and primordial cyst. The KCOT is a distinctive form of developmental odontogenic tumor that deserves special consideration because of its specific histopath features and clinical behavior. There is general agreement that the KCOT arises from cell rest of the dental lamina. This tumor shows a different growth mechanism and biologic behavior from the more common dentigerous cyst and residual cyst. KCOT and their growth may be related to unknown factors inherent in the epithelium itself or enzymatic activity in the fibrous wall. Several investigators suggest that odontogenic keratocyst can be regarded as benign cystic neoplasm rather than cyst. Clinical features. Age occur over a wide age range, and cases have been recorded as early as the first decade and as late as the ninth. In most series, there has been a pronounced peak frequency in the second and third decades. Gender, more frequently seen in males than in females. And situs, mandible is involved far more frequently than maxilla. 50% cases occur in angle region and extend to ascending ramus and forward to body of mandible. This is the site distribution. This picture shows 49% of the cases involve the ramus region and then followed by the maxilla 20%, and then again in the mental foramen region 7% and in the symphysis region 9%. Usually asymptomatic pain may occur when secondary infected mild swelling or discharge. Occasionally, paresthesia of the lower lip or teeth. Some are unaware of the lesions until they develop pathological fractures. In many instances, patients are remarkably free of symptoms until the cysts have reached a large size, involving the maxillary sinus and the entire ascending ramus, including the condylar and coronoid processes. Occurs because the OKC tends to extend in the medullary cavity and the clinically observable expansion of the bone occurs late. Now the radiographic features. Location, most common is body and ramus of the mandible. Epicenter, superior to inferior alveolar nerve canal. Periphery, KCOT demonstrate a well-defined radiolucent area with smooth and often corticated margins, or it may have a scalloped outline. Internal structure, totally radiolucent. In some cases, curved internal septa may be present that give it a multilocular appearance. Effect on surrounding structures. KCOT grows along the internal aspect of the jaw, causing minimal expansion. KCOT can displace and resorb teeth, but to a slightly lesser degree than dentigerous cyst. May displace inferior alveolar nerve canal and maxillary antrum. On aspiration, dirty creamy white viscoid suspension is seen. In this radiograph, a small odontogenic keratocyst can be seen. Again, odontogenic keratocyst is seen with scalloped margins. This radiograph shows multilocular odontogenic keratocyst. You can see here. And in this radiograph, an odontogenic keratocyst that has enveloped an unerupted tooth to produce a dentigerous appearance. Differential diagnosis, dentigerous cyst, adenomatoid odontogenic tumor, ameloblastoma, कैल्सीफाइंग एपिथीलियल ओडोंटोजेनिक ट्यूमर, सेंट्रल जॉइंट सेल ग्रैनुलोमा, एनोरिज्मल बोन सिस्ट, एंड ट्रीटमेंट इज सर्जिकल एक्सीजन. कॉम्प्लिकेशंस इन ओकेसी इज मैलिग्नेंट ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन ऑफ सिस्ट लाइनिंग रेयर बट हैज बीन रिपोर्टेड. रिकरेंस हाई रेट ऑफ रिकरेंस इफ इट इज ट्रीटेड नॉट कंप्लीटली. Reasons for recurrence is thin fragile lining is very difficult to remove completely. New cyst developed from satellite cyst that left behind. Some cyst may be left behind in cases of Guillain-Barré syndrome. New cyst can also develop from basal cells of overlying oral epithelium, especially in ramus third molar region. Now the eruption cyst. Eruption cyst is typical clinical feature of an eruption cyst is bluish colored dome shaped swelling over the unerupted tooth. The dentigerous is developed around the crown of an unerupted tooth lying in the bone. The eruption cyst occur when a tooth is impeded in its eruption within the soft tissues overlying the bone. Eruption cyst involves the maxillary permanent central incisors. In this picture, you can see clinical feature found in children of different ages and occasionally in adults. If there is delayed eruption, then only it is seen in adults. Site most common associated with the first permanent molars and maxillary incisors. Radiological features, the cyst may throw a soft tissue shadow, but there is usually no bone involvement, except that the dilated and open crypt may be seen on the radiograph. Now, the lateral periodontal cyst. It is uncommon but well-recognized type of odontogenic cyst. The designation lateral periodontal cyst is confined to those cysts that occur in lateral periodontal position and in which an inflammatory etiology and a diagnosis of collateral OKC have been excluded on clinical and histological grounds, according to Shear and Pinbergs in 1975. Lateral periodontal cysts are thought to arise from epithelial rest in periodontium lateral to the tooth root. This condition usually is unicystic, but it may appear as a cluster of a small cyst, a condition referred to as botryoid odontogenic cyst. Clinical features, age 20 to 60 years, peak in sixth decade, male predilection is high, and lateral PDL regions of mandible premolars followed by anterior maxilla is the site. Sign and symptoms, usually asymptomatic as it occurs on the lateral aspect of root of tooth. Occasionally pain and swelling may occur. Associated teeth are vital unless otherwise affected. Cyst rarely less than 1 cm in size except for botryoid variety, which is larger and also a multilocular lesion. Radiological features, location 50 to 70% occur in the mandible, most lateral incisor to second premolar, and periphery round to avoid radiolucency with sclerotic margins. Internal structure totally radiolucent. Effect on surrounding structures, small cyst may efface the lamina dura of adjacent tooth. Large cyst may displace adjacent tooth and cause expansion. In this radiograph, a lateral periodontal cyst lying between the mandibular premolar teeth, the margins are well corticated, indicative of slow enlargement. In the first radiograph, you can see a radiolucent lesion between the roots of vital mandibular canine and the first premolar. In this second radiograph, lateral periodontal cyst, a large lesion causing root divergence. Differential diagnosis, periapical abscess, mental foramen, and treatment is surgical enucleation. Now the inflammatory origin cyst. Radicular cyst. Radicular cyst, also called apical periodontal cyst, root end cyst. Radicular cyst is a cyst that most likely result when rest of epithelial cells of molluscs in the periodontal ligament are stimulated to proliferate and undergo cystic degeneration by the inflammatory products from a non-vital tube. Clinical features: age, peak in 3rd, 4th and 5th decades. Sex is slightly more in males, and the maxillary anterior region is the most commonest site, and frequency is the commonest cystic lesion or jaw, as I told you earlier also. Sign and symptoms: primary symptom less, patient may complain of pain when secondary infected. Slowly enlarging hard bony swelling initially. Later, if cyst breaks through cortical plates, lesion becomes fluctuant. Diagnostic criteria is associated teeth are non-vital and it is rare in deciduous teeth. Radiological features. Location: epicenter is located at the apex of a non-vital tooth. Periphery, well-defined. Cortical border. If infection supervenes, the margins become indistinct, making it impossible to distinguish from a periapical granuloma or abscess. The outline of radicular cyst is curved or circular. Internal structure is radiolucent. As you can see in this radiograph of a radicular cyst, the lesion is well defined. Radiolucency associated with the apex of a non-vital root filled tooth. Effect on surrounding structures. If radicular cyst is a large displacement and resorption of adjacent teeth, root may occur. If it is large, the resorption pattern may have a curved outline. The outer cortical plates of maxilla or mandible may expand in a curved or circular shape. On aspiration, the contents of cyst may vary from brown to straw color depending on contents of cyst. Differential diagnosis: periapical granuloma, periapical abscess, and management is RCT or extraction of the tooth along with the removal of cyst and followed by complete curettage. Now the residual cyst. A residual cyst is a cyst that remains after incomplete removal of the original cyst. The term residual cyst is used most often for a radicular cyst that may be left behind, most commonly after extraction of the tooth. It is usually asymptomatic, some expansion of the jaw or pain in the case of secondary infection. Radiographic feature: occur in both the jaw, slightly more often in mandible. Epicenter is positioned in the former periapical region of the involved and missing tooth. Periphery, oval and circular in shape, has a cortical margin. Internal structure typically radiolucent. Effect on surrounding structure: it can cause tooth displacement or resorption. The outer cortical plates of jaw may expand. In this radiograph, you can see appearance of a large residual cyst left behind after the extraction of first mandibular molar. Differential diagnosis: periapical granuloma and odontogenic keratocyst. Lesser degree of expansion as compared to residual cyst. Management is surgical removal. Now the non-epithelial lined cyst. It consists aneurysmal bone cyst. Uncommon cyst found mostly in long bones and spine. The term aneurysmal bone cyst was suggested by Jaffe and Lindstein in 1942 to describe the characteristic blow out of the lesion. Clinical features of aneurysmal bone cyst is age is third decade, most commonly seen, and mainly in females. And the most common site is molar region of mandible and maxilla. Sign and symptom shows hard, rapidly growing swelling, usually buccal or labial, which can cause malocclusion. Pain is an occasional complaint and the involved area may be tender on palpation. If lesion perforates cortical plates can cause eggshell crackling. Radiological features. Location. Mandible is commonly involved, 3:2 ratio. Molar and ramus region. Periphery well defined and the shape is circular or hydrolic. Internal structure. Small initial lesions may show no evidence of internal structure. Often the internal aspect as a multilocular appearance. Septa present at right angles to the outer expanded borders, mainly they are ill-defined and wispy. Effect on surrounding structures. Aneurysmal bone cyst produces a radiolucent area which produces an ovoid or fusiform expansion of the bone and may balloon the cortex, may displace or resolve adjacent teeth. On aspiration, dark venous blood can be seen. Radiograph of an aneurysmal bone cyst involving the angle and ascending ramus of the mandible. There is a ballooning expansion of the cortex. Differential diagnosis of aneurysmal bone cyst is ameloblastoma, cherubism, giant cell granuloma, and management is surgical curettage or excision. Now, the Stephanie's bone cyst, also known as latent bone cyst or static bone cavity or mandible salivary gland depression. It represents a group of concavities in the lingual surface of mandible, where the depression is lined with an intact outer cortex. Majority cases have been reported in males over 40 years of age. Clinical features. Asymptomatic, non-progressive lesion unless discovered during radiological examination. Radiographic feature shows the location below the inferior alveolar nerve. As you can see in this radiograph, this is the inferior alveolar nerve, and below the inferior alveolar nerve there is a radiolucency and anterior to the angle of mandible. Periphery well-defined. Ovoid or occasionally lobulated radiolucency, 1 to 3 centimeter in diameter. Margin of radiolucent defect is well defined by a dense sclerotic radiopacity margin of variable width. Differential diagnosis is odontogenic cyst and treatment no surgical intervention required. Now the cyst associated with maxillary antrum. It involves mucocele. It is an expanding destructive lesion that results from a blocked sinus ostium. Blockage may result from intraenteral or intranasal inflammation, polyp or neoplasm. As mucus secretion accumulate and the sinus cavity fills, the increase in intraenteral pressure results in thinning, displacement, and in some cases destruction of sinus wall. When the cavity is filled with pus, it is termed as empyema and pyocele. Clinical features shows may exert pressure on the superior alveolar nerve and cause radiating pain. Patient complains of sensation of fullness in the cheek and the area may swell. swelling may become apparent over the anterior inferior aspect of the antrum. The area where the wall is thin or destroyed, it expands inferiorly, may cause loosening of posterior teeth. There may chances of nasal obstruction and may cause diplopia or proptosis. Radiological features. Location occurs in ethmoid air cells in frontal sinus. Periphery, normal shape of sinus is changed into more circular hydroiolic shape as the mucosal enlarges. Internal structure shows uniformly radiopacity. An effect on surrounding structures is shape of sinus changes as the margins are displaced outwards and bone expansion. Teeth may be displaced or root resorbed. Differential diagnosis, a large odontogenic cyst. And treatment is surgical with a Caldwell look operation to allow the excision of the lesion. Now the retention cyst. Uncommon variant of mucus retention phenomena most frequently encountered as an incidental finding in dental radiograph. This lesion appears to represent a retention phenomena of mucus glands associated with lining of maxillary sinus. Clinical features, mainly asymptomatic, occasionally discomfort in cheek or maxilla. No age and sex predilection, pain and soreness of the face and teeth and numbness of upper limb were described by Wright in 10% of the cases. Buccal expansion may be seen. Radiographic features shows location floor of the sinus, may form on the lateral walls of the roof, may vary in size from fingertip to completely filling the sinus. Periphery shows the well-defined non-corticated smooth dome-shaped radiopaque mass. Internal structure shows homogeneous and more radiopaque than the surrounding air of sinus cavity. Effect on surrounding structures. There is no effect on surrounding structure. Differential diagnosis. Odontogenic cyst or tumor, enteral polyps, and management is resolved spontaneously. Now the cyst of the soft tissue of the mouth, face, and neck. Dermoid cyst. They are cystic form of teratoma, thought to be derived from trapped embryonic cells that are totipotential. They are lined with epidermis and cutaneous appendages and filled with keratin or sebaceous material. Clinical feature shows dermoid cysts most commonly occur in the midline of the floor of the mouth. This is the floor of the mouth and here, the midline region. Cysts that occur below the geniohyoid muscle often produce a submental swelling with a double chin appearance. They are most common in children and young adults. Swelling is slow and painless, can grow into several centimeters in diameter. May interfere with breathing, speaking, and eating. Radiographic features. Location may occur anywhere in the body, mainly on floor of the mouth and tongue. Periphery, well-defined by more radio-opaque soft tissue. Internal structure, when it occurs in oral cavity, they appear as radiolucent on conventional radiographs. CT scan gives a multilocular appearance. Differential diagnosis, ranula and cellulitis. Management is surgical removal. These are the some investigations which we can use during the if we like to rule out these cysts. So In conventional radiology, we can use periapical X-rays, occlusal views X-rays, lateral oblique views X-rays, and panoramic X-rays, PA view X-rays, and sinus view X-rays or PNS. And in digital ones, CT scan and MRI can be used, CBCTs can be used, radio-opaque dyes, aspiration, and biopsy that will give you the final diagnosis. Now the various aspirates. Pathologies like dentigerous cyst, odontogenic keratocyst, periodontal cyst, infected cyst, mucocele, gingival cyst, on aspiration they shows a color of flu. Like dentigerous cyst on aspiration shows clear pale straw color fluid. Other findings of aspirate: cholesterol crystal, total protein in excess 4 gram per 100 milliliter, resembles serum. Odontogenic keratocyst shows on aspiration dirty creamy white viscoid suspension. And other findings are parakeratinized squamous, total protein less than 4 gram per 100 milliliter, mostly albumin. Periodontal cyst on aspiration shows clear pale yellow straw color fluid. Other findings are cholesterol crystals, total protein 5 to 11 gram per 100 ml. Infected cyst shows pus brownish fluid on aspiration and polymorphonuclear leukocytes and cholesterol clefts. Mucocele and ranula shows mucus on aspiration and gingival cyst shows a clear fluid on aspiration. Solitary bone cyst shows serous fluid, blood or empty cavity on aspiration, and other findings are necrotic blood clot. Stephanie's bone cyst shows empty cavity, yield air on aspiration. Dermoid cyst shows thick sebaceous material, and fissural cyst shows mucoid fluid on aspiration. These are the references. Thank you.